Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Anomalous Realities. I am your host, Shaman Lanita Elder. And tonight, I have in studio with me, as always, Marky Mint. Good evening, Marky. How are you doing? Or good morning.
good evening, morning, Lanita. Yes, doing well, and glad that, five or six episodes in, and we got the intro music going proper that time.
Sweet, isn't it? It's awesome.
Good to be back.
And we also have Melina in studio with us tonight. Hello, Melina. How are you doing?
Great, great. Happy Friday to y'all. Busy weekend. I have a birthday tomorrow.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm going to have my oldest boy is turning 9 years old.
Oh, well, happy birthday to him. And it's so close to the 4th. Do you guys do like fireworks and stuff for his birthday to kind of make it feel special?
Sometimes he asks for fireworks, but we do have them in the house, but that's for the 4th of July.
Yeah.
If I can keep them out of them.
Now, you guys have any big plans for the 4th?
Just every year he sets off his own little display, and we live in Saginaw, so we can go and walk down to see the big fireworks display.
Okay, awesome. Well, now, we also have a guest with us in studio tonight. Our guest is Brian Forrester. He is an author, and he is a researcher. He runs Hidden Inca Tours. And, boy, it's just an honor to have you with us tonight, Brian. You have been on Ancient Aliens, and you have worked with a lot of fascinating people, have you not?
Yes, I have, and thanks. It's an honor to be here.
Wonderful. So, first of all, what are your plans for the 4th? Are you doing anything?
Actually, I'll be in Lima because a group of 30 people are coming in that we're taking on tour. So I'm somewhat
So you'll be
detached.
Doing a tour.
Yeah. So I'm somewhat detached from American celebrations now.
Right. Right. So are you living in Peru full time right now?
Yeah, I have been for about 6 years.
Okay. So what is the, what's it like? What's the differences like culturally there between, you know, the United States? What are those differences?
Extremely different because most people who live in Peru are Native American and speak Spanish and, you know, have quite a different cultural background as compared. There's some fireworks going off right now.
Oh, my goodness.
And so, yeah, it's I actually have always liked putting myself in a position where I'm a minority, because that way I learn a lot more about different people.
Now, I read a little bit about you. You've kind of had an interest in Native people since you were very young. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's true. Ever since I was a young child.
So how did that first spur in you? I mean, what started that? How did you become so curious about the Native people?
I think I was in grade 4 and our teacher actually started reading Native legends from the coast of British Columbia, where I lived. And I just found their oral traditions much more fascinating than the standard white, you know, perspective kind of thing.
Yeah, the Anglo. Okay, that makes sense. So, because you grew up and you started doing sculpting, correct?
Yeah.
So how did that transition from, you know, the interest in the sculpting? How did that transition into kind of the research that you do now into, you know, the indigenous histories as you are?
Well, I spent a number of years studying how to carve totem poles and things like that with Native people, and I turned that into a profession. But then after a period of time, my interest started to move into Polynesia, which I spent a long time traveling through and studying. Mm-hmm. And then about 12 years ago, I just decided that I should visit Peru and see Machu Picchu. And I fell in love with the country and the ancient traditions here. And that began my journey.
I can totally understand that. I think since the very first time I saw anything about Machu Picchu, I felt almost an instant, immediate draw to it. And I mean, the place itself is just absolutely stunning and fascinating. I mean, just if you look at the photos, you have to wonder to yourself, how is this even possible? You know, how did these people build this, you know, on top of a mountain thousands of years ago? It just boggles the mind. Is that where your study started, or where did you start, you know, kind of looking into the ancient mysteries?
Well, yeah, my initial interest was Machu Picchu, but I didn't go there until the end of my first trip. Mm-hmm. I wound up traveling all over the country, learning about the Inca, but also there are many other ancient cultures that lived in Peru. And so I did quite extensive traveling on the coast, a little bit in the jungle, and then up in the Andes area. And I just found so much. Variety of ancient cultures, all quite different from one another. And mm-hmm. So that was the beginning, I guess.
Wow. So now I think the thing that introduced your name, you know, into my reality was your research into the Paracas skulls. So I'd really like to ask you, you know, how did you first come in contact with those, and you know, how did that start?
Well, actually, I saw them on TV and on different TV shows and mm-hmm. things. And normally, of course, they're labeled as being alien or something.
Right.
But it was when I went into a very small museum in Paracas, Peru, mm-hmm. that the director, Senior Juan, had a actually mummified Paracas royal head
wow.
on display. And I looked at it and went, oh, my God. And then he said that he had more at home. So I said, can you bring them to the museum so I can look at them, mm-hmm. which he did. And then after that, I started looking up on the internet, you know, in different archaeological areas, looking for information about these people. And there was right. almost nothing. And so that began my study, because there were no academics who knew much about the elongated skulls of Paracas.
Wow. Now, how did you come about to actually get the DNA testing and all that done? How did that come forward?
Well, it's been a really painful process, because most of the ancient DNA or labs that study ancient DNA, of which mm-hmm. there are only 10 or 15 in the world, they won't touch a subject like this because it's too, I guess they would call it fringe. So
right.
it's been a difficult process. We did get one geneticist to do one study, and he found that there were certain segments of the DNA that didn't match anything known to be human, mm-hmm. which was interesting. But then he was immediately fired for even dabbling into this topic.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know that. So he lost his job for actually stepping into this and you know, saying, hey, you know, this DNA isn't what we know as human.
Yeah.
Wow. Have you been able to go any further with the research beyond that?
Yes, we have, actually. I'm working with a number of different people. We have a lot of funding. We're also working with the Peruvian government, with their Ministry of Culture.
Oh, wonderful.
So we've been able to test five elongated skulls recently from Peru, four of them being Paracas, and they show that they have ancestry of people who did not cross the Bering Land Bridge. So they have non-Native American DNA.
Hmm. That's interesting. Now, I was going to say, have you done any research on the other skull, the Star Child skull?
I was actually closely associated with Lloyd Pye for about 2 years,
mm-hmm.
up until his death. And so he was completely fascinated with the Paracas, and we were organizing to bring him down on tour. But unfortunately, he died quite rapidly.
Oh, my goodness. Now, what were the circumstances of that? Was it natural, or what happened to him?
No, he had a very aggressive tumor in his abdomen.
Oh, no.
And he tried alternative therapy.
Right.
But then over the course of some months, he just rapidly
downhill. Rapidly decreased. That's a shame.
Yeah, and died.
Now, I think I've met, isn't there a woman now who has possession of the skull, the Star Child skull?
Yeah, there's actually what's called the Star Child Foundation.
Oh.
And I think her name is Amy. I haven't been in contact with her for at least a year, but I believe they're still raising money to do some more in-depth DNA testing.
Okay. Yeah, I think I met someone that was associated with it about, I think it was 2 years ago at the UFO, at the Ozark Mountain UFO conference. And they actually, I think they had the skull physically there, if I remember right. Certainly, that would be kind of cool to get. It would be neat if I had both of you on at the same time talking, because you guys could, you know, share info about your skulls. that would be kind of cool. Now, have you ever done any work with any of the crystal skulls? Have you tried to compare, like, you know, I've heard that there was actually one crystal skull that was somewhat elongated. Is that true?
I think there's one that is slightly elongated, but supposedly the, you know, the 13 original skulls that come from Central America, mm-hmm. Are, you know, the real ones,
right.
Are in the possession of different people. I was also at a thing called Contact in the Desert last month at Joshua Tree, and a native elder brought one of the 13 skulls and let me hold on to it.
That's awesome. Yeah, I actually won a pass for Contact in the Desert, but it was so last minute I wasn't able to get there. I wanted to, because that would have been so amazing. Because, I mean, I went to the UFO conference this year, and there was a lot of people there at the Ozark Mountain one, but Contact in the Desert, it had like everybody this year. So I mean, it was a veritable who's who of the UFO community. It was pretty amazing. So did you find anything new when you were there this year? I mean, did you meet anyone that just kind of blew your mind with something that you learned?
Actually, I must say that the man who impressed me the most was a native Zuni elder called Clifford Mahudi.
Mm-hmm.
And he spent a lot of time with my wife and I just, you know, talking story about things. But I did, you know, I met some of the most famous UFO investigators in the world, which was really, you know, it was great to, you know, meet 20 people you've seen on television for decades.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Eric Von Daniken was at this year's, in the Ozark Mountain one. And I know he was there at Contact in the Desert with you, and my sons were with me, and they just, they kind of rock star fanboyed over him big time.
Yeah,
they definitely did. They had a lot of fun with that. And he has an awful lot of information. I think, did you read his books when you were younger?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think anybody that's in this type of a field of research had to have been, you know, inspired by him at some point in their lives, because his books were just, I think at the time they were so out there and cutting edge, but they really inspired people to think outside the box in ways that nobody else ever had.
Well, definitely. If it wasn't for him, nobody would have heard of the Nazca lines,
mm-hmm.
or they wouldn't have thought that the Great Pyramid in Egypt could have been made by someone other than the dynastic Egyptians.
Right.
So he definitely laid the seeds for, you know, probably people like Graham Hancock and others and myself.
And you've worked with Graham, have you not?
I have.
Yeah. So what was that like? What did you have you ever actually like written anything with him or?
No, I wrote a number of articles for his website. And
okay.
He was here in Peru, I think 4 years ago,
mm-hmm.
on a big tour with me.
Yeah. Now he was probably down there. And when he was in Peru, he was working on Supernatural. So he did some of the shamanic journeying with the ayahuasca. Have you ever done that?
Yes, I have.
Now, can you remember your experience? Would you share it with the listeners?
In some way I can.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I think that too many people are using ayahuasca too much.
Is it that common now? Has it become something that is just kind of like a trendy type of thing or something?
It is. It's basically
it's part of
the tourism industry now.
Oh,
which is
no.
which is terrible. So I prepared for my experience for 2 years, and mm-hmm. it was one of the most mind-boggling, incredible experiences of my life. I can basically say, if any of your listeners are acquainted with doing sweat lodges, it was like doing 1,000 sweat lodges in one day.
Wow.
So it just, it released so much childhood trauma, gave me insights, et cetera. It's a very profound medicine.
Wow. I remember reading in his book that a lot of people had seen a green goddess. Did you experience anything like that?
Actually, I didn't even have visions. What I was able to see was going from normal reality, which I relate to being watching television, mm-hmm. black and white TV with broken rabbit ears, to high definition cable. It was just so, my senses were so profoundly opened.
Wow.
And that's why an experience like that can only last like 3 or 4 hours, because mm-hmm. your brain has a very difficult problem with trying to figure out what's, at least your logical brain is having a very difficult time with trying to figure out what's going on. Whereas your creative brain is going, you know, bring it on. It's great.
Yeah. I've heard that there are studies saying that it actually works really well as far as curing depression in people and things like that. So, you know, I have to wonder why substances like that, which seemingly, I mean, they have sacred properties to them, why they're banned, why the government seek to prevent people from having those experiences, especially when it seems in some cases that they're actually healing experiences.
Well, actually, ayahuasca, when used properly, can cure cancer. It can cure anything.
Well, that's certainly a reason I think they wouldn't want it, because
the pharmaceutical companies, the psychiatrists, psychologists, etc., are trying to protect their way of life. Mm-hmm. But definitely in the future, I think we have to move back more and more to these natural remedies in order to become healed and evolve.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Now, the Paracascos, there was something I remember reading about them that was very unique, in something about the cranial capacity or something. Was unusual and compared to a normal human skull, and suggested that it wasn't wrapped. Do you know what I'm speaking about?
Yeah, I've studied all of the cultures around the world that did mm-hmm. what is called cranial deformation, which is binding the skull.
Right, skull binding.
But it's only among the Paracas on the coast of Peru, and then one or two cultures in the highlands of Peru and Bolivia that had skulls 2,000 plus years ago that are so complex in design that they could not be the result of binding. They had to have been natural.
Mm-hmm.
And the most profound thing was that 2 days ago, I was at Lake Titicaca with a radiologist from the United States, who is an expert on the human skeleton. And when I showed him photographs of the Paracas skulls, he said, "Those are not human."
Mm-hmm.
Meaning,
and I wonder...
Oh, sorry, but meaning they're not Homo sapiens sapiens. They could have been an ancient branch of humanity that died out.
Well, that could be. If that was the case, could that lend to perhaps the findings of, you know, cave drawings that show, you know, beings that have larger cranial skulls than, you know, the normal human being? Because, I mean, who's to say where these beings, you know, whether they're terrestrial or extraterrestrial? We don't know that for sure. We just know that they're not human.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. has there been any further, theories that go beyond just the basic extraterrestrial as far as, you know, where these skulls, what these, is there any other evidence as to what these people might have been or where they might have been from?
Well, the one problem we have is that through the DNA testing, we can mm-hmm. never prove that they had alien DNA, because what the computers do that do the study of genes or, mm-hmm. you know, anyone's ethnicity is that all they can do is compare, for example, your DNA with what DNA is known. And right. so obviously standard DNA testing is comparing human to human.
Right.
And so the program, if it found DNA segments that were not human, it would simply say unknown.
Right.
And so I think the more, as DNA testing becomes more refined in the future, more and more of some of these Paracca skulls will show DNA, which is, technically unknown, but that simply means that we don't know who these ancient branches were.
Okay. Have you ever visited, there's that spot that they have that it's like a Stargate, that rock that's kind of the doorway carved into the stone, and there's been legends of the peoples that, you know, sometimes they go there and then they just disappear. Have you been to that spot?
Yeah, it's called Amarumuru. I've been there probably 20 or 30 times.
Wow.
It's very close to Lake Titicaca. It's actually only half a mile away from Lake Titicaca.
Okay.
But it's an ancient doorway or portal that's been carved into sandstone bedrock. And mm-hmm. we actually did have a group of energy dowsers there about 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And they said there still is energy moving in and out through that portal.
So it would just be that it would take the right person knowing, you know, having the right attunement perhaps to the doorway to actually get it to work again. What is the what would be the most recent story, I guess, from the indigenous people there of someone actually using that doorway?
Well, actually, the fortunate thing about that place too is that the government doesn't control it. It's the local people who take care of it. So mm-hmm. all of the money earned from tourists going goes to the local community. But their basic story is that they have no idea how old it is. It's mm-hmm. much older than the Inca. And that at night, what happens is balls of light will come in and out of it. Most of them are quite afraid of the door and wow. will not go there at night. But I've asked at least 10 or 15 different local people at different times, and they all uh-huh. say this. They all say the same story, that it's balls of energy or balls of light that go in and out.
That's fascinating. Have you ever witnessed it firsthand?
No, but actually we have had people with us, and they you know, who are very sensitive in nature, and mm-hmm. they have felt the energy, and some of them have been afraid to go too close to it.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Is it because they're just afraid of the energy itself, or do they feel a negativity in the energy? Did they say?
No, I don't think it necessarily a negativity. It's just the
unknown.
Well, the powerful nature of it. It's
okay.
Whatever the energy is that's moving back and forth, it's beyond what we are. So I think,
right.
you know, in the case of that, or in the case of seeing aliens or something, there's a natural fear because like a fear of something superior to you, which you can't control.
We have an innate fear of things that we don't understand. It's just that simple. I mean, it goes back to our earliest times. So I think it's 100% natural. Have you been at that gate at nighttime?
No, we've actually only been there during the daytime.
I would be curious to see, you know, if you actually witness something like that. You should go back at night sometime. I would love to hear what your experiences are. You might make that one of those things, you know, a trip to do.
Well, the only problem with that is it's the same with seeing UFOs, is that if you try to plan it, it never works. But if you know, these experiences come to me completely when I'm not looking for them.
Mm-hmm. Have you seen a UFO?
I have had three very profound experiences. Yeah.
Can you share them with us? I always love to hear people's personal UFO experiences. I've had several of my own, and I know that they're very unique to the person, and sometimes they're not the same. They can be very different. So I would love if you would share some.
Sure. Well, actually, first I have to say that anyone who says that UFOs don't exist have never seen them.
Exactly.
And that's the basic thing. They say, you know, anyone who says, oh, that's nonsense. It's like, have you seen one? Well, no, of course not, because they don't exist. Automatically, you're shutting yourself off from ever having an experience.
Mm-hmm.
So my first profound experience was on the island of Maui when I was about 36. And my brother-in-law and I were driving up country on the side called, or, you know, the mountain called Haleakala. And I saw this airplane that was the size of a normal jet, but it wasn't in the right airspace. And so I was quite curious about that.
Mm-hmm.
And then as I looked at it, I noticed it didn't have a tail or wings or windows or any insignia. It was like a tube.
Like a smooth cylinder.
Yeah, like a cylinder, which could have meant that it was a disc on edge. I wasn't sure. But also it looked like it was traveling about 20 miles an hour. So I thought, how can an airplane move so slow?
Yeah.
And so it's just the thing is that your logical mind is trying to
explain it.
Yeah, trying to put it in a box, and there is no box. So yeah. I was able to observe it for about 10 minutes. And again, my brother-in-law was the one driving, and I didn't turn to look at him. I didn't open my mouth I didn't point. I didn't take a picture, because when you see something that bizarre, all you can do is look.
Yeah, that's. You know what's funny is that is actually, I think, one of the only types that I've seen more than once. I've seen that, just like you described, kind of like a cylinder. It had no tail, you know, no windows, just a cylinder moving slowly, about three different times. And they were all three times it was in Northwest Arkansas. So, yeah. At one time it moved, it went behind a invisible wall in the sky. So, like, as it's going, it starts to vanish as it goes behind a point in the sky. So there had to be something that it went behind that you couldn't see, because it was like you'd only see half of it and then you'd see a quarter of it. It was really weird. That was the last one I saw. So now what was the next one?
Well, the next one was actually at Paracas about 2 years ago. I got up at 1:30 in the morning for some reason, and I went outside and I saw these 12 glowing balls about 5 miles away. And they were moving coordinated, you know, with each other, but they weren't moving in a circle, like they were in a circle formation, but it was almost like they were moving on a petri dish, because they were moving in different ways, but coordinated with one another. And so after I stared at that for 5 minutes, I called my wife out, and I pointed at the sky, and she just said, those are UFOs. And she and I continued watching them for about 5 minutes, and then they gradually went up and then disappeared.
Wow.
But again, you know, my mind went through the basic things of, well, those are birds. And it's like, well, wait a second. It's like 1 o'clock in the morning. There's no moon. Those things have to be generating their own energy. So that was my second one. And actually both times I got this feeling in my solar plexus. I can't explain why, but it's just, you know, that's where the subconscious is looking at something going, this can't be real, but your eyes are seeing something which is real.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Well, it's almost like it was almost interacting with maybe one of your chakras on a, you know, an energetic level. That's really amazing.
Well, I think so, because, you know, because my basic life now is looking at strange phenomenon, ancient lost cultures, etc.
Yeah,
I think I'm tuned into them, and I think for, you know, occasionally they like to show themselves to me as if that's maybe the next level that I'm, you know, to pursue.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's funny. I can't remember who I was talking to about this, but we were discussing how some people see, you know, how some people can see a UFO and other people can be there and not see it. And we discussed the fact that possibly there's like an energetic difference in the frequency that you vibrate at, because, you know, we all vibrate at different levels and different frequencies, and perhaps people with a higher vibration can see things that perhaps other people can't.
Oh, I think definitely. It's the same with seeing ghosts or any other phenomenon. If people aren't open, you know, if their energy centers and their minds are not open,
it lowers their vibration.
To the possibility, then they simply won't see them, and then they'll continue to deny that any of this stuff exists.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So you said you have three.
Yeah, actually, the last one was about 2 months ago at Paracas. I was on the top level of the house looking, it was like 9 o'clock at night. I was looking out at Orion because the air is so clear on the coast of Peru that you can see the constellations really easily. And this was like a golden glass ball that went right in front of me, or from south to north, about the size of a soccer ball. Mm-hmm. It was silent, and I just watched it as it went to the north and disappeared. But it didn't look like it was a ball of energy. It looked like it was energy inside of a glass sphere. So I continued to stand there waiting for the other ones to come by, but it was the only one. But I, you know, as I speak about it now, I can visually see exactly what it looked like, how it was moving. Uh-huh. And I think, you know, again, it was a probe or something simply saying, guess what? We're real. Goodbye.
Now, can you explain what it looked like a little bit more?
Again, it was like a glass ball, mm-hmm. Seemingly about the size of a soccer ball or maybe bigger.
So mostly clear.
It was just like bright sun energy inside. It was like a little sun going past.
Wow. Fascinating. And it was pretty small too. That's interesting. You know, I've heard one other person say, that they had seen something like that once before, but that was a really long time ago. I wish I could remember who that was. Now, did you have, you know, a feeling like that in your solar plexus at that point in time as well?
No, actually, this time I was just I was just completely fascinated and quite comfortable with it.
Oh, okay.
That's why I stood around outside waiting for the rest of them to come by, but. Mm-hmm. It was only that, and you know, I know some people would think it's crazy, but you know, I can see it in my mind's eye right now exactly mm-hmm. as it happened.
Yeah, I have to say I understand that completely, because when you have an experience like that, the memory doesn't go away. I mean, it can't. It's like it's ingrained forever in your mind. People always ask, you know, why don't you have video? Why didn't you go get your camera? When you're in that moment, that's the last thing you're thinking of. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Did you get a camera?
Well, again, in all three cases, I could not take my eyes off of it. So I couldn't physically move because my eyes and my mind were so fascinated with the phenomenon, and I wanted it to last as long as it would last. So if I went into the house, it could disappear, and I didn't want that.
Yeah, that's exactly the same thing for me. It's like, somebody actually just shared in our call a link to a YouTube video of I guess a UFO similar daytime strange gold ball of light, and there's a UFO video. I'm gonna have to try to Marky, can you post that link in chat or just post it in the Skype window so I can share it in the chat room with the viewers? We've got some listeners in chat that are just Jaro2 said they didn't want to interrupt our flow because they were really enjoying the show so far. I'd like to share that link with the people that are listening so they can take a look at it. And who knows, you know, maybe they'll be able to relate to their own sightings. Marky, do you have our call-in number?
I don't know them.
Oh, no. Well, okay. We have a Skype contact for anybody that wants to call into the show and ask a question. We've still got several minutes left. So if you have a question for Brian, you can contact us via Skype by calling Freedom Screen 2. And then I've got the call-in number. I'll grab it real quick. Now, if you want to call on your cell phone or landline or anything like that, we have a call-in number that you can call, and I'm about to get it up. All right. It is 310-421-4053 if you have any questions at all for our guest tonight. And now, what are some of the other things? Because I know that the Paracas skulls and the UFOs are not the extent of your research. So what are some of the things that you've come across in your research into the ancient indigenous cultures that have just kind of shattered some of your previous conceptions about the world?
Well, I guess the main thing are the megalithic structures that you find in Peru, Bolivia, Egypt, Lebanon, and other places. There are structures here in the city of Cusco, where I'm located, mm-hmm. that archaeologists claim the Inca made, but clearly they were made with lost ancient high technology. So in some cases, some of these stone structures could not be replicated by us today. And since the Inca were a Bronze Age culture, I've come to find out, and through writing my latest book, that the Inca, when they appeared in Cusco 1,000 years ago, they found an abandoned city that had been destroyed 12,000 years ago.
Wow. Wow.
And also, but also it's the same in Egypt. The Great Pyramid, mm-hmm. Was not built by the dynastic Egyptians. When the dynastic Egyptians appeared in that part of the world 5,000 years ago, they found that the pyramids were there on the Giza Plateau, as well as many other structures. So the basic theory I'm working on is that there was a global cataclysm 12,000 years ago that destroyed any of the advanced civilizations that existed at that time.
Wow. That's actually something that Graham Hancock kind of went around and around with the Egyptian officials on, I think. And boy, I'm kind of really glad that Zahai Hawass is no longer in charge of the of everything in Egypt, because they bumped heads a lot over those theories, didn't they?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, standard Egyptologists at this point are trying to defend theories that don't make sense scientifically. Where the more trips we take to Egypt, bringing engineers and other, you know, physicists and people like that, we're scientifically showing that some of these structures have to be 12,000 plus years old.
Yep, and which I think is scary for the scientific community, because they're always trying to support the things that have already been said. And that just kind of tears apart everything that we know of our history. These civilizations go back well beyond what we are supposed to have had, you know, when we are supposed to have first had civilization, which really suggests that we've already had a civilization. And we have a caller coming in. I'm going to add them to our call. Hello, caller.
Hello, I didn't mean to interrupt. I was willing to be on hold until I could make a... Okay, so I first have to say that I'm profoundly impressed, sir, with your communication skills, your listening skills, your transparency, and how you articulate an answer to a question. I'm just really blown away. It's very rare to hear someone do all those things so well.
Thank you.
You're very welcome, very deserving. I'm very, you know, the authenticity of your response to questions and the way you describe things has a sincerity that I seldom hear in interviews. So I don't have any specific question. I'm transfixed. Okay. All of the questions and answers.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, caller.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. We also have a question from the chat room. Jaro2 has asked what you think about consciousness.
Boy, that's a big question. I think we are eternal. I think the more that we evolve personally and release ourselves from the shackles of government and, you know, standard religious control, that we come to, you know, we come to a realization that we're here for an experience for however long we want that to be, and that when we pass over, it's our decision as to where we go.
Awesome. Oh, goodness. And now they wanted me to address that, but I'm going to do that at the end of our hour because we only have you for 1 hour. So I want to stay on topic with you. Make sure that we, you know, cover as much as we possibly can because hour goes by so quickly. So we were talking about the 12,000-year-old civilizations and what that could possibly mean. And I think one of the things that I find so fascinating, and I want to know if you've done any research into this, is the Anunnaki stories and the statues that are available that have been found that have reptilian-type beings. Have you done any research into that at all, that whole the depictions of ancient reptilians in our past?
I have to a little extent. I really mm-hmm. don't dabble too much into parts of the world that I haven't physically been. I would love to go okay. to Iraq and Iran at some point, but what I do know, you know, of the name Anunnaki means the uniting of heaven and earth. So it could, you know, it could have a spiritual meaning, or it could literally mean that beings came down from elsewhere and mated with, you know, earth life forms and right. created this this hybrid. That the same with the Nephilim in the Bible. You know, mm-hmm. I interpret that more as being something alien than something that, you know, that the high God made a mistake and created these right. these life forms that had to be wiped out.
Yeah, I have to agree on that. And considering the fact that, I mean, when you consider the Anunnaki, I mean, they literally, they explain in all the histories that they're not from here, that they're from the stars. There are other beings that have come to visit that have told, you know, the indigenous people where they're from, you know, be it whether it was Sirius, whether it was Pleiades. And for some reason, you know, modern day historians and scientists just kind of, I guess, laugh in the face of these ancient stories because the people weren't civilized, that they don't trust the word of them and that they just all made this up, which if they think of them as so, you know, less of them, less scientific than them, then how would they know of these constellations where these beings came from? That's one of those questions that, you know, you always have to ask is, you know, if these people, you know, are so uncivilized, if they have no knowledge compared to the rest of the world, then how do they know of these places that these beings came to them from?
I know, exactly. It's an obvious form of racism that Western science uses. Mm. Almost every indigenous society that I've encountered have stories about the fact that at least part of their ancestry comes from off planet. And as you mentioned, Sirius and the Pleiades are the two most profound mm-hmm. ones. And you can't have these different cultures who have never been connected with one another all over the planet stating, you know, we are at least in part star beings. Yeah. And I also spent 4 years studying Darwinian evolution in university. And it is, you know, it is called the theory of evolution for a reason, because yeah. it still is a theory. It's not concrete fact.
It's funny how people treat it like it's fact, though.
Well, unfortunately, science is a big boy and girls club, and mm-hmm. they will defend their theories no matter what. But thanks to independent thinkers and the internet, we're able to use science not against them, but to counter some of their claims, again, about how old some of these stone structures are.
I find that so ironic because it kind of seems to go against, you know, what the whole purpose of science is, to make yourselves so closed and believe that one theory, once you've said it as a theory, is the only answer, and to not consider the other answers, to not do research into the other answers and take them seriously and at least look for the evidence and try to weigh evidence against it. It's almost like a pseudoscience that's being practiced when people close themselves off like that.
Well, unfortunately, that is the case. And, you know, as you get more and more, or as I do, involved in archaeological studies, and you bring other disciplines in, unfortunately, a lot of archaeologists have not consulted with geologists in terms of what kind of stones these structures are made from, mm-hmm. where does the stone come from. They don't consult with stonemasons to find out how some of these things could have been made. They just make up their own theories. And so what I'm doing is more multidisciplinary. Again, that was the great thing about 2 days ago with this radiologist studying the Paracas and other skulls. And he said there are too many characteristics of some of these skulls to have them be what we call human. They are either a different kind of human or they're not human whatsoever. And that's, you know, I'm very grateful to be working with so many different, very intelligent people.
Yes, you're very, very fortunate. I found on your site, and that's the hiddeninkatours.com, which you have a lot of articles on your site that our listeners should really look into. But the one that I'm interested in right now is the ancient hieroglyphics found in the highlands of Peru. Can you talk about that a little bit?
I don't honestly remember what that one is.
Oh, no. So there's... there's hieroglyphics apparently that were found in Peru. Now, I know that they've actually found hieroglyphics in Australia. They found them in the northern part of the continent in North America. So there's suggestions that, you know, Egyptians have been here in the past. But apparently there were some found in Peru as well.
Oh, well, unfortunately, my website is so huge. I have 830 YouTube videos on it.
Wow.
The only reference I can think of is that the Inca themselves had a form of hieroglyphics, mm-hmm. but it wasn't Egyptian. It was like a coded language that almost nobody knows about except me and a few people.
Huh. Now, do you have other people that submit articles for your site as well?
Not yet. We're actually working on a brand new website called hiddenhumanhistory.com.
Oh, really?
And so that's going to be a global database for any researcher that wants to contribute to this mega database can do that.
Okay. When will that launch be?
I think within a month.
Okay. Now, Marky has a question for you. So, Marky, would you like to come in?
Sure. Well, I was looking at Hidden Inca Tours website myself earlier, and I was just wondering when you run these tours, what sort of reactions do you get from people, and what sort of walks of life are these people coming on these tours?
Well, we're fortunate in that we get people from all over the world. In general, they're people who know that the traditional history that we've been taught isn't complete. Many of them have read Graham Hancock's books or whatever, but none of them, of the hundreds of people who have come on our tours, have left believing traditional history anymore, because we literally take them to these megalithic sites where they can touch, feel, and measure the precision of the stonework, and they all leave convinced that that they've learned something that conventional history either denies or will not accept or doesn't even look at.
Brilliant. And how often do you run these tours?
My wife and I do them about 25% of the time. We could easily do 10 times as many as we do, but we don't want to spoil the quality of the experience.
Excellent. That was the question I had, Lenita.
Thank you.
Cheers. Okay. Brian.
Cheers.
Now, what are your theories on the pyramids? Not just the Egyptian pyramids, but the pyramids all over the world. I would love to hear your thoughts on, you know, the pyramids that are being found just about everywhere.
Okay. Well, that's a great question, because One of my great teachers is a man called Stephen Mailer, who has been studying Egyptian history for more than 30 years. Mm-hmm. And so there are many fireworks going off. There are many pyramidal structures that you can find in Central America, Egypt, and many different islands. But when you look for the term pyramid itself, the word pyramid comes from the Greek, which is pyromidos, and that means the fire within. So what a true pyramid is an energetic structure. And so that's why the ones in Egypt are thought to have been actual functioning energetic machines 12,000 years ago, whereas many of the other pyramidal structures you find around the world have more of a spiritual or earth energy kind of function.
Huh, that is fascinating. Okay, really quick, I want to allow you to go over your websites and also your books so people can look them up if they, you know, if they're interested in finding out more.
Okay, my main website is hiddenincatours.com, and it's developing into quite a major database. It's not simply a tour thing, but I have 830-something YouTube videos. I've written 19 books, have many articles, photo sets, interviews, etc. on them. And there's also a search function. So if you were to put in Machu Picchu, you'd wind up getting videos, photo sets, interviews, etc. about that specific topic.
Okay. And what books do you have that people can look up on Amazon or other websites that they could find?
I just published my 19th book, so they're all located on my website and through Amazon.
Okay.
And I'm now halfway through writing about Akhenaten, the great pharaoh of Egypt.
Oh, okay. So you've heard about that dagger that they found was a meteor that was made of meteorite. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, actually, other artifacts have been found in ancient Egypt made of meteorite material. So I'm not all that surprised with that.
What do you think the significance is? Obviously, they really knew what they were using. I mean, they did make things out of meteorite for a specific purpose. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, basically, I think that meteorite material is so rare that mm-hmm. it would be more highly prized than gold. And having come from the heavens, you know, perhaps it was a gift from the gods, but also it may have energetic properties because it's not of this earth. So it could be used for something other than a normal kind of use.
Okay. We have about 1 minute left before we're going to go to break. And since you are not going to be with us for the second hour, I just really want to just take a minute to thank you for being with us tonight. And gosh, you know, we probably could have got into a lot more stuff, but maybe when your next book comes out, we could have you back and we could do, you know, another talk. But yeah, I really want to thank you for coming on and for sharing all of your information with us and all of your knowledge. And I really wish you all the best in your research in the future. And if you have anything, any projects going, you know, that you want to promote, you're welcome to do so.
No, actually, I'd love to come back and
wonderful.
Chat with you anytime because there's a lot more to cover.
And, excellent.
You know, my whole function on this planet is to share everything I learned because there's no sense in me holding on to it.
That's the purpose of the radio show, too. It is here to bring information to people that they may not have gotten in another form. And it's information that I feel is important for people to have. It's information that people need to know. And the information that you are bringing forward, I feel is very important for people to be aware of. So, like I said, I really want to thank you.
My pleasure. Thanks to you and thanks to your audience.
Thank you very much. And so now we're going to be going to break in a minute. When we come back, we will be discussing a few new topics for the night. And Mark and Melina will be back with us. Music for the studio break should be coming in any moment. I know, right?
But
there it goes.
There it is. themirror.co.uk. Do you believe the Paracca skulls could have come from aliens? 56% of people say yes, and 44% say no.
We'll talk about that after the break. Welcome back, everyone. I just want to take a quick minute to remind everybody that we are here as a courtesy of Revolution Radio, and Revolution Radio is a user-supported station. So if you like what you're hearing and you enjoy the show and you want to hear more, just take a minute and visit the website, freedomslips.com, and click on that little donate button. Without the donations of listeners like you, you would hear nothing but silence when you tune in. So if you like what you're hearing and you want to keep hearing more information that's new, it's different, it's something that you're not going to hear on your CNN or your Fox News or any of the network stations, you're not going to read about this in the newspaper, give them a donation. And let them know that you appreciate what they do here, because we certainly appreciate it. And so we are coming back, and that was interesting, wasn't it, guys? We got Melina and Mark with us, and what are you guys' thoughts on, you know, kind of just everything we kind of covered there? That was...
Well, I've always loved the Paracca, the mystery the surrounding the Paracca skulls,
yeah,
and the Star Child skull. I've always been very fascinated with what DNA tests will uncover, and it's very frustrating to hear that they come up against so many roadblocks when trying to get those answers.
I think it's a big step though that they, you know, they had the DNA test done and they're actually able to say that it is nothing, it's not regular human DNA. It's not, they can't, it's an unknown. It's not connected to a normal human being, which means it can't just be skull wrapping. Because if it was just skull wrapping, the DNA on those skulls would come back as human match, but it didn't. I mean, this is huge. I mean, they're always asking for evidence, you know, of extraterrestrial life. Well, this doesn't prove it was extraterrestrial. It could be a different species of humanoid that is indigenous to the planet, but it is certainly something new, historically speaking, that we have never come across before. So, I mean, it's shattering. Marky, what are your thoughts?
Well, I agree. The fact that it's relatively new information makes it more exciting. Before the break, I was mentioning a article. Well, it was on the Express, Daily Express website, not the other one I said. Mm-hmm. On there it's, the article went up on New Year's Eve, just gone. So that's around the period where this information was apparently coming out. And that's interesting. I mean, by sending it anonymously in a way to be tested, mm-hmm. or at least not telling them anything about really where it came from, so that you get an unbiased response. That was a good idea, I think.
You know what I found interesting was that I read an article that they tried to get Purdue to do their own test on stones from Pumapunku, and they refused to do it because they were trying. Yeah, and they absolutely refused to do the testing. Which
had they mentioned the name to them beforehand or something? Come from here.
I think they knew, you know, what the question was, you know, and it's interesting how much of the scientific community just really kind of rears back against having anything to do with proving that, you know, what we currently have believed to be our history may not actually be our history. And they don't want to be associated with shattering those illusions, I think is what it is. And they're probably afraid that it'll ruin their careers. And, you know, it may well, if we remain in the dark, you know, about things that we think, you know, are history when they're actually not. There's a lot of hidden history. And I think that new website he's got coming out should be very, very fascinating. I'm very curious to what we'll find, you know, the different stories that they're going to share with there. Because I'm sure there's a lot that, you know, we can't cover everything in an hour. It's just not possible. There's too much. There's just way too much.
We did learn some good stuff, but you're right. I mean, Peru and like Brazil, you have to have an open mind about that. I don't even think you really need to be a historian or even into like UFOs and aliens to know that there's some special things about that sort of region of the world.
Right. Yeah.
And I mean, someone like myself who does have a basic understanding of like ufology and whatnot, I mean, you just can't ignore like the activity. Brian was speaking about his UFO encounters and such. Mm-hmm. And it's just so active there in all these ways and the Nazca lines and everything. It's, you need to, if there's one place in the world where you have to maybe, you know, scientists could at least think there's a bit more to it around there because of just what goes on. So
yeah,
much.
Yeah, there's so much there that just it flies in the face of what we know. It really does. It's just inexplicable. Because they believe these people to be so primitive, and yet they accomplish things that you would need so much knowledge to do. It doesn't add up. It just doesn't. I also, you know, I found his UFO sightings very, very interesting. And Mark, have you ever shared your UFO sightings? Because I know you're into ufology. So I'm really curious. And now, before I have you share, I'm going to say I'm wanting to get some more firsthand accounts of UFO sightings tonight. So to our listeners out there, if you're feeling brave and you would like to share, we like to hear new experiences from other people. So give us a call on the phone lines 310-421-4053 or Freedom Screen 2 on Skype and share your UFO experiences with us. But now I'm pointing at you right now, Marky, because you don't get this into ufology without having an experience or two. And I know I've shared mine pretty openly, so I'd like to hear one or two of yours.
Well, yeah, I mean, I've always generally held a belief since a kid that the universe has many mysteries to it, that so, you know, I had an open mind. But my UFO experiences are sort of quite boring, but kind of, you know, they as I think was mentioned earlier, a sighting will reaffirm things for yourself and, you know, will give you those sensory things that mm-hmm. convince you it's not. You know, it's abnormal or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's what I experienced. I believe Brian said his first one looked like a tube or something.
Right.
Well, that's kind of what I saw. It's first time. This was 2006, mm-hmm. autumn time. And we live in a fairly flat area, so I can see, you know, horizons. There's no hills or anything. And this tube-like sort of semi-lit thing went over from the west to the no this was from the well, from one direction to the other. I can't remember. North to south to west. I'd have to think about it. This was at my parents' garden. I can't remember right now, but that went over, like, you know, I could see it start at one horizon, went mm-hmm. passed over my head and down the other horizon in literally 10 seconds flat.
So was a fast one.
So that's something I never, that's a speed I could never fathom in my brain up before.
Yeah.
And then about two or three years later, I saw exactly the same one the night that I'd been first introduced to the tether incident video. I had to go to work that and was just thinking about it. And I was in the center of town in a slightly darkened area, like in this little park you walk through the town, just looked up. And another one of those things shot past in the opposite compass direction, so west to east and whatnot. And that was just when I thought, wow. I've been shown two of these things, and that's when I became slightly obsessed with sort of infrared videos, because I believe that's a way to see these sort of things. That's just confused me. And there's been a couple of other ones which I don't really know. I'm still a bit on the fence about whether I actually experienced it or if I was, you know, I don't know. They were too confusing. But these ones were definitely something that goes very, very fast, very quickly, and would be visible to anyone looking but they'd have, you know, it would be, there was no way I would have ever got that on film or anything like that. But for the experience alone, damn good.
You know what's funny is the last one, the last one that he shared, he said it was like soccer ball size. And you know what it made me think of is when Barbara Lamb was on, she was talking about the craft that would create the crop circles. Now the craft that she experienced, though, was larger than that. But I tell you, in my mind's eye, whenever I think about crop circles and how they're created, I always imagine it to be a rather small circular craft. And I don't know why that is. But that's just the mental image I get. And I almost kind of got that feeling. But then he talked about it being clear and having like this kind of sunnish glow in there. And I'm almost wondering if he didn't actually see like an entity more than a craft, but more like, you know, an actual being or, you know, consciousness of some kind. I don't know.
Definitely. Well, I'm at odds with this sort of thing because you have so many reports of like cylindrical metal UFOs and whatnot. But you do also have this element of just sort of energy, plasma, maybe biological even sort of sightings. So, I mean, there's just such a mix. It's hard to tell. But yeah, I would say. But then any of the things he saw and any of the things you and I have seen could be one or the other.
Right. I mean, there's always that possibility. I mean, who's to say that a life form doesn't have illumination? I mean, I've seen beings that had, you know, self-illumination when I was a child. So who's to say that something in the sky couldn't be biological, organic, and have an illumination as well?
We have fish that light themselves up, don't they? They have lights on or inside them. I don't know how that works, but... they could just be self-illuminating aliens that are flying around. I don't know. Well, I still from my experiences, I need to do what I think is right to find out more information about it. I've been slack about that.
You can't just. This is something I've said. Look, we talk a lot about different theories, okay, and we share a lot, and yes, we go down the rabbit hole very, very deeply, but you always have to do the research, and you always have to keep some level of, you know, not really sure, and you have to have that not really sure verdict in your mind, because if you just instantly jump to a conclusion, you're, you know, that's just putting the cart before the horse, and it's not staying true to, I guess wisdom is the best way to put it.
Yeah.
What's the term, Marky? Deny ignorance? Yeah.
That's a certain term from a certain website.
I think we can all relate to that. Well, we can mention it. I mean, abovetopsecret.com is, you know, that's where we all met.
True. Deny ignorance. Yeah. But, and they call it healthy skepticism as well, don't they?
Well, yeah. I mean, you have to have... Look, if you don't have some amount of skepticism, then that just kind of makes you gullible, right? You can't just blindly believe everything. and if you don't have some amount of skepticism, how can you have any certainty that what you experience or what you think is actually valid or true? You have to have some level of rational thinking in order to validate your theory to some extent. You have to question it. If you don't question it, question everything is one of my big mottos. If you don't question it, you're never going to learn anything. That's part of science, right? It used to be. Nowadays, we're not questioning history anymore, right? That's part of why these scientists don't want to be affiliated with, you know, the research that's being done that is really taking into account everything that we're being told and just kind of standing it up on its ear. Melina, you have been quiet tonight.
Uh-oh.
So where are you standing here on the UFO subject? Because, you know, we're kind of going down that UFO rabbit hole right now.
Well, my first UFO experience was back in, I was 19 years old. So it would have been 1995.
Mm-hmm.
Way before cell phones, way before digital cameras. you know, it wasn't even a thought to carry one of those with
me. Yeah.
Just to put that out there right away. So, no, I don't have any evidence.
For all the people that do have video, I know we talked about that earlier.
Well, I was coming home, and it's a long drive into the apartment complex. There's a long road that goes along as you're driving up to get to where my mom and me and my brother were staying. And I was driving up, and all of a sudden, my radio went, and my car stalled out, and my window was rolled down just a little bit on the driver's side, and I could hear a humming, and that's what drew my attention. When the car just stopped, I was like, what the hell? And I could hear this humming, and so I looked to the left, and in the sky, I would say about 20 feet in the sky, and it was partially obscured by a tree, there was in the sky this just blinding, brilliant, egg-shaped light. And it would have been about the size of a Volkswagen. You know, it was very large. And I was so excited that I didn't even think about trying to start my car back up. I just got out of the car and ran the rest of the way up the drive to where our apartment was, and pounded on the door for my mom to let me in because my keys are in the car. And I'm like, I saw a UFO, come look. I saw a UFO, come look. But she didn't go and look. And then I had to think about going back out there. Uh-huh. That's when the fear and trepidation comes in. I'm like, oh, crap, I left my car out there.
Yeah.
And I had to walk back and get it, but it was gone.
It was gone by then, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's just as surely as you got into your house and started talking to your mom, it probably took off.
Yeah. And that was the first, that was my first experience. The second experience I had was with a friend. And it was just a few months later. It would have had to have been about half a year later because we were living in a trailer at that time. After we moved out of the apartment complex. Mm-hmm. And this is way out in the middle of the country. But I had a friend, and I was deeply in to ritual, working with Wicca and paganism. Mm-hmm. And so we were going out to a roadside park that had a river that cuts through by it to do a ritual. And we left about 9:30. We left when it was still light out to get out to this park, and we got out there. And we were out there, and we left maybe a half hour to an hour after it got dark. So it was probably going on 10:30, 11 o'clock when we were mm-hmm. leaving. Well, the reason we were leaving was because in the tree lines, we could see light, what looked like flashlights almost, like uh-huh. carrying flashlights coming through. We're like, oh, crap, you know, somebody's coming. We better get out of here. You know, not that we were doing anything wrong. There was nothing wrong with being where we were at, other than it was at nighttime at this point, you know.
Right.
I don't know who the heck's coming at us through these trees. So we jump into the car to leave. When we get back to the trailer, 4 hours of time had passed, and we have no clue what happened to them. We left the park at what we thought was around no later than 11, and we didn't actually pull up. And it's only about a 20-minute drive.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't pull up until 3:30 in the morning.
Oh.
So
you lost time,
a whole bunch of time. We lost like 4 hours. Wow. 4 hours. Couldn't figure it out. Still can't figure it out to this day.
I can figure it out. in honesty, you know.
Yeah, but that's scary.
Something you don't want to face, but yeah, you know.
Yeah, I've seen the blue orbs of light. They're no bigger than maybe a softball.
Hmm.
I see those a lot. My husband woke me up probably about a year ago.
Uh-huh.
I was sleeping, dead sleep, and he was up. I don't know why he was up at 5:30 in the morning, but it was still dusky out.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, Mel, get up. There's a UFO. Come here. Come look. Get up. You know, so I'm so used to it now from doing that. Usually they're little stars in the sky that are zipping back and forth. Well, but this time when I got up, it was a blue orb coming down the road. It was almost it almost seemed like it was translucent, but you got that feeling that it was an entity rather than a craft.
Like what we were saying, yeah.
Yeah, and it was coming straight down towards us, and then when it got about 20 feet from us, it just all of a sudden started going right. It was like coming straight at us, and then it just started going right, and it was just the way that it moved, and it was just very interesting experience. But that was my last experience.
Wow. All right, now, real quick. Now, that is really interesting that you said that, because we were just talking about, you know, the fact that they could be entities. And you have to think, you know, you have to wonder, you know, just how many times that there's a UFO sighting that it might actually be an entity. And you have to wonder, what could they be? You know, what might they be? It's just one of those things. Okay, let's see. Oh, we've got Rodrigo in the studio with us. Rodrigo, you there?
Yes, hello, how are you?
Hey. So you had something to say about the crop circles.
Yeah, initially when I first saw them, I thought they were like landing pads for UFOs. And following the work of an individual many years ago from 2001, he's a Montauk boy, and Montauk was involved in time travel experimentation, genetic manipulation, mind control and programming. And in one of his books, and even having a discussion with him, because I've met him a few times, he basically stipulated that the spherical or the symmetrical type of crop circles, you know, which are repeated patterns.
Yes.
So an example of that would be the flower of life. They are constructed at the Brookhaven National Laboratory and then broadcasted using electromagnetic frequency to the area in a sort of energetic 3D form, but the residual effect leaves a 2D imprint on a flat surface. So the flower of life, for example, is actually a 3D star tetrahedron which has spheres on each of its points and overlap each other. Now, if you sync that, let's say, from above the ground to below the ground, as it passes through, it creates the residual image of a flower of life.
Oh.
So that's like a 2D representation of a 3D image.
Yeah. That's interesting. So that would actually make some sense, that I could see something being done like that. It's kind of like what is it, psionics? Where
radionics. Yeah. It's like planetary radionics. It's it was used, he didn't write this in his books, but it says it sort of does help with weather manipulation.
Mm-hmm.
Does help with climate control and things like that. Mm.
But why would they use that to do that?
I have no idea. That's the psychopathic people in control who are controlling this planet. I mean, I'm not one of them. I have no idea why they would do such things.
Strange.
Just other than to continue the control system.
Yeah.
Mm.
So now we got you here. So
yeah,
I'm gonna stick you under the gun. Have you had a UFO sighting? Because we've been all on the UFO topic.
Yeah, I haven't.
You haven't?
No, I haven't.
That is shocking, because I feel like you have had them around you. Perhaps you didn't notice them. I don't know why I get this feeling, but I just have this overwhelming feeling that you have had UFOs around you.
In the dream state. That's a different story.
Oh, really?
Mm.
Okay. Share.
nothing extravagant. They're just like flashes of imagery that I recall. Uh-huh. Alien beings and being communicated with, but it's just not enough information to make anything of it, really. I'm thinking they might just be dreams, but you know, you can tell the difference between a normal dream and an astral dream, and you can tell the difference between an astral dream and a programming dream. I've had more religious type of dreams. satanic sort of dreams, you know, Satan involved, satanic ritual sex involved. Yeah, I'm not getting into that, but those are the more the programming dreams. But I have had the inclination of something there, especially just because of the dreams. I've had more spiritual experiences rather than alien encounters.
Right.
Yeah, there's something there. I haven't really delved into it, to be honest.
So they've MK altered you.
Well, that's what I was told. Yes.
Yeah, it would seem so. If you're having programming dreams, then they definitely.
Yeah, it was. I was actually told to me by that very same person, the Montauk person, the Montauk boy. He did say that I'm a monarch programmed, obviously, like as one of the bigger ones, with Omega function. Now, the Omega function is a self-destructive function if programming doesn't activate.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I've been struggling since, let's say, 2000 with not wanting to be around or, you know, thoughts of self-manipulation. Not manipulation, but, you know, just degradation of my own life.
Right.
So that's Omega, like the ending.
I think you need a spirit walk is what you need.
What's that?
Well, ayahuasca is one of the ways that you can have it, but it is usually for the average person, it is induced by a plant type substance that will take you on a journey out of this reality and into a non-dimensional area where you will be able to interact with goddesses. But what it does is it allows you to have a connection with yourself. It helps you reestablish your oneness with everything. And I've had so many times I've read of people saying, you know, how they after having an experience, be it it's usually a drug that's banned that brings this about, like LSD or you know, or pure DMT, it will cure depression, because depression is brought on by people's disconnections with their self.
Okay. I've actually improved in my mental health status in the last couple of days in the last week, let's say. But this is the interesting part. I'm going to say my world has turned to absolute crap in the last week, but I'm the happiest I've ever been in a long time.
Well, then your world's not going to be crap for much longer.
Okay, because
you draw you the frequency that you go into. And so if you're going into a really happy place, now is really the time to focus on your goals and what you want.
And creativity and projects that I want to do. Yes, I have been. I have been in the last couple of days. And you know, a few days ago I slipped over and nearly broke my foot. I had a Reiki session on that. The next day it was fine. And just financial problems, usually, just you know, things that everyone goes through. And we've because of the government, Australian government, you know, sort of cutting on expenses and costs for people who are on pensions and whatnot, it makes it really difficult. But that is going to change as of 2 weeks.
Oh, really?
From what I know, it's going to go in a positive direction. With the DMT, I had a nice experience with that. The humming sound, I don't know if anyone knows, but I hear this hum, and I think it's the pineal gland activating.
That could be. And I've heard that hum when I'm meditating, so.
Right. Yes, and actually my depression has started to lift since I started meditating again.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's just what's going on recently in a nutshell. But, yeah, my vibration, mental vibration is different to the physical circumstances right now. But they have to match, don't they? So it's bringing it up.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things that is really important when you're dealing with your frequency and you're trying to manifest what you want in your life. When you decide what you want, you have to make sure that all of the parts of you are in agreement with each other on making sure that they want it to happen. So you've got three parts of you. You've got your body, you've got your mind, and then you've got your soul, your spirit. And it has to align with everything. So perhaps, you know, your mind thinks that you want something, but your spirit doesn't actually want it to manifest. That can get in the way of it, or your heart doesn't want it to manifest. So you have to be willing to accept it on all levels and know that you're ready for it on all levels. But then the thing is once you get one of the most important things to understand is that once you get into a really high frequency situation, which is when you're just in a state of happiness, of bliss, like when you're watching a comedy movie, this is a really good time to focus on your dreams. If you're just laughing and enjoying yourself, or you're in a moment where maybe, you know, there, you've just got love pouring out of you, you're in one of those moments where everything is just magic, that is when you put in your mind what you want. That's when you focus on it, because that is the time when you have the best chance of pulling it to you and manifesting.
Okay, because of the positive vibration, it's a more powerful manifesting energy, yes?
Yes.
Mm.
And you need to hold on to it. One of the things that's suggested, I just finished doing an audiobook that should be available very soon, but it is called The Frequency. And in it, it talks about how to actually master this and be able to use your frequency to manifest what you want and bring it to you. It's kind of like, you know how The Secret came out and it told people about the law? Okay, this goes beyond that and actually tells you how to implement it in reality.
In actuality, yeah.
Yes.
Because I found that The Secret, you know, they say, you know, visualize what you want, but your subconscious could be totally against what your conscious mind wants.
Right.
And I'm thinking that the manifestation comes from your subconscious, not your conscious, because it is 99% more aware in an unconscious state. So, yeah, okay, so it's called The Frequency. It's coming out soon.
Yeah, yeah. It'll be out in audiobook form probably in a couple of weeks. Let's see, the author is Linda. Let me get it up here real quick. All right, I almost got it.
Cool.
Here we go. Oh no, that's not there either. Okay. Well, I almost had it. But she actually, the author that wrote this, Linda West, she actually got to work with Terrence McKenna in Peru.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So she got a whole lot of interesting information. She has been doing this for a lot of years. She's done a lot of research on it. When I started reading just what she was talking about, producing this for her, I resonated with it very, very strongly. I try, you know, when I'm doing work to do work that I can resonate with, that I feel is true to, you know, what I'm trying to accomplish in the world. And so this one is definitely, and I'll tell you what, because I get codes to give away free copies when they come out. So when this comes out, I will do a giveaway to the listeners, and I will give out codes for this so that you guys can listen to it for free. Anybody that wants more information on how to manifest your reality, this audiobook will be really good for you. So,
excellent.
Yeah, so good, it'll be a couple
of
weeks.
Have you got a link? So who was your author? Sorry.
Linda West.
Linda West, okay.
Yes, and you can actually read. She's got a couple of hardcovers out. So if you look her up on Amazon, you can find her hardcovers.
Okay, cool. I found her already.
Yep. Yeah, it comes up quickly. So, yeah, and I've talked to her about maybe coming on the show so she can, you know, talk to the listeners about it directly a little bit, because there's such a difference, you know, in reading a book, but in actually talking to the author and asking her questions, because they get to elaborate more on things that way, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. So I think that's something that you should do, because I want to see good things happen for you. And if you're getting in a place where you're working from a high vibration, you're going to start being able to manifest better what you want to come to you. Because it does work, but it's not easy. I mean, that's why so many people got disillusioned, you know, with the Secret. Because it's one thing to know it, but it's another thing to implement it. And so understanding the proper process of how to do it to actually make it work, that's a whole nother thing. You know, that's
and making it a habit as well.
Because
through indoctrined programming through life, we have, you know, developed bad habits in the way we think and in the way we do things. So, I mean, that's one thing that The Secret didn't touch on, was to implement a full-on habitual change to the way to manifest, not just doing a visualization board or, you know, wishing for it to come true or something like that, but, you know, something of intent. It's got to be powerfully intentive. Mm-hmm.
And I think she's actually just finishing up on another book right now that I think is called The Secret Didn't Tell You. I'm hoping to get her on so that, you know, she can kind of, so that, you know, the listeners can actually call in and pick her brain and find ways that they can manifest what they need in their reality. Cause I think it's really important that everybody is able to understand this. Cause can you imagine the kind of world we lived in if the positive people, the people that weren't power hungry, understood how to actually make what they want manifest?
Yeah.
It'd be a much nicer world.
Mm.
So I think that's why it's been kind of kept in the dark for such a long period of time.
Yes. And what I find with the powers that be using the secret or the law of attraction aspect, and I know there's many laws, but specifically the law of attraction, they've sort of made the populace do their bidding, like through their manifestation in what they want. So they don't have to do anything. So it's like the next level.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. Have you got any books yourself, Lenita? I mean, I've listened to your shows.
I'm working on it.
Such a wealth of information.
Okay. I am working on it, actually. And here's one of the weird things is I'm horrible at writing, you know, so what I've been suggested by people to do is to actually like take, you know, the audio of the stories that I've told and try to just convert it to text, which I don't know if that would truly do it justice. But here's what happened. When I was at the UFO conference, I was asked to do a speaking engagement in Tulsa, Oklahoma, which I did a couple of weeks ago for the Near Death and Other Mystical Experiences group. And so I go to that group and I do my speaking engagement there. And then I did readings afterwards for the various members that wanted to have readings done for them. And a couple of different women came up to me and they said, I know why you're here and I know why I came today. And I was like, okay. And they both were ghostwriters.
Oh.
They're like, I'm going to help you make your book. I'm going to help you get it out there. And so I have not one, but two ghostwriters that are going to be working with me now to help me make this happen. And I'd actually just been talking about a couple weeks ago how I've just been really kind of just being almost punched by my guides. It started with a nudge, you know, that I needed to get the book written. And now they're just kind of punching me, saying, come on, you've got to do it. Yeah, they're trying to make me focus my direction and change it. And so I'm doing less of my audiobook work now and doing more focus on my shaman work and more focus on the radio show because these are part of what my path is meant to be, whereas that's just income. That's just, you know, that's just income.
Yes, yes. But it's just an added bonus to what you're actually doing and what you're passionate about. Mm.
So when I find the projects that actually can help with my journey, I will do those. But otherwise, I'm taking a step back from that right now. So that's why that's probably actually the frequency one is probably the last audiobook I'll be doing for a while because I'm going to be focusing on my shaman work more now. Beating me up about it. My guides are beating me up about it.
Tell me about your shamanism, your shaman work. I know a long time ago, I think it was about 3 or 4 years ago now, you did a reading for me. Mm. And I don't recall what it was about, but what is shamanism? Can you explain that? And
it's a healing. It's about healing. We're kind of like the first shaman were like doctors back in the day, but we were more than just physical doctors. We're spiritual doctors as well. I found out I was a shaman when I was 16 years old, and it made a lot of sense to me because my life was so full of paranormal things. And even then I wasn't ready for it because I was told by an elder shaman in my tribe that I was a shaman, and I wasn't ready for it. And I didn't really accept it. I was 16 years old. I didn't even know what a shaman was or what it meant.
Well, at 16, you don't know really what life is about just yet.
No,
either.
No. Mm-hmm. So it took me time, but What she explained to me was that in my work, I'm a spiritual healer. I'm a natural spiritual healer in the fact that she told me that from my earliest time when I would interact with people, I would naturally heal them through my interactions with them. And that was something that would continue to be whether I chose to walk the path or not. She said it didn't matter if I got training because it wouldn't make a difference. I would still continue to do what I was put here to do regardless in some form. So that didn't even make a difference. But a shaman is a person who is often called in a couple of different ways. One, their veil is thinner than it is for the average person. So shamans usually have a lot more paranormal experiences, a lot more UFO sightings, things like that. And that's just part of our normal. So when I understood that, and she didn't really explain that to me either. It was later on that I found and understood that. So that's just kind of their normal. But that's also part of how a shaman works, because we have a connection to the ancestors, to the spirits around us that is much closer than the average person because that veil is thinner for us. I guess, right. I think it's vibrational. You know, we were talking earlier about how one person can see a UFO and a person next to them can look and not see anything. Okay, this is because there's a difference in their vibrational and in the vibrations that they are living at and on. If someone is in a lower vibrational place, they maybe can't see something that's of a higher frequency than they are in. So we are able to interact with beings of different frequencies than the average person, I guess, is a good way to put it. And by doing that, we can transfer the knowledge from them to the person that needs it, transfer healing to people that need it in different ways and forms. I've actually gotten to a point, this was one of those things that I just instinctually did. I had, my daughter had to have she had her lung collapse and they had to put a chest tube in her. And as a result, there's actually a lot more mystical experiences regard to that. But as a result of that, she had problems with nerve damage afterwards. And she was in a lot of pain and she was taking pain pills that would become addictive to her if she didn't get off of them. And I was getting really worried about that. And so this was kind of a couple of years ago when I was really still in the infancy parts of working, you know, as a healer. And I don't know why I just decided to try to heal her. And I didn't even put my hands on her. I had her stand in front of me and I did an instant meditation where I pulled white light healing energy down into me through the crown of my head and channeled it into my hands and then held my hands right around the area where her pain was. After that day, she didn't take any more pain medicine. Ever again.
Wow.
So, and I've not done it a lot of times. I only do it when I feel that there's a need, you know. There was actually a woman that, there was a situation where I was at a place where there was a woman that was needing healing and it wasn't the right place for me to do it, but I wanted to heal her and I couldn't do it because we were actually in a church. I don't think shamanic healing would have gone over well in a church. So I didn't do it at the time, but I gave her my number and I told her that if she ever needed me, that she could contact me. So, but I did help her with a lot of things that day, actually. That poor thing, she didn't have any air conditioning and the heat gets bad, as bad here as it does in Australia in the summer times. It's really bad. It gets up to, in the Fahrenheit's, our heat index has been well over 110 to 115 degrees with the index.
And that's about 45 degrees Celsius. That's really hot.
Yeah. So that's the heat index temperature, but our base temperatures get up to 110. Our average is between 100 to 109 usually. And that's before the heat index, and it's humid here, so this poor lady had no air conditioning, and I knew I had to find a way to help her, and I put it out there to the universe that we needed to find a way. And I actually tracked down a place that does, they will help people who don't have air conditionings. They will give them $130 towards getting one. And so she was able to get in touch with them and get help getting cooling for her home.
Fantastic.
So she wouldn't. Yeah. So that was really, really good. And that's that, like I said, that's kind of one of those ways, you know, it doesn't seem like it's like a magical healing, but it's something that needs to be done. And when you see something in life that, you know, a need that's there and you know that you can fill that spot, you have to try.
Yeah.
That's something that I think needs to happen on a grander scale all over the planet. And I'll tell you what, Rodrigo, there are a lot of shamans out there that don't know they're shamans. And that's okay, because they're doing the work that they need to, regardless of, you know, whether or not they're aware of it. But there are a lot more healers out there than they know. And they're just, they're blind healers, I guess you could say. There's natural healers out there. They're out there helping, and they're doing a lot. They don't know that that's what they're doing. They don't know that they are a healer, but that's what they are. You can use any name you want, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I connect and resonate with shaman because I was told by a shaman that I am a shaman. But that doesn't necessarily have to be the term that a person uses for themselves. A healer is a healer. A healer is someone that heals people in, it could be a physical sense, it could be an energetic sense, or it could be a spiritual sense. There's lots of different ways that people can be healed. And I think eventually, I don't think I'm a baby shaman anymore. I've been a baby shaman for quite a while. I'm starting to emerge into kind of, I guess, an adolescent, maybe an adolescent shaman. But I think when I get into being a true elder shaman, which is ironic because my last name is Elder, I think I will be able to heal on all the levels fully. You know, beyond... I will be able to, I know I can do the physical healing. I know I do the spiritual healing, and I know I'm able to give the guidance with my gifts that I have helping people. And I'm getting more comfortable with that without using the cards too now, which is something I've never actually done before, but I'm getting
like
better at
feeling,
that.
Better reading without cards. Yeah.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. So I'm getting to that point. So I'm starting to emerge a little bit more. I had, and I mentioned this on the show, but I don't know if you were listening, but I actually had my guides finally come to me about a month or two ago.
No, I didn't hear that.
And they finally showed themselves to me. And it was an amazing time for me because it just filled me with joy. Because my guides are both ancestors, and they're both Native. And when they came to me in the dream, I knew immediately who they were. It was just the strangest thing. But they were with me in a wooded area, a forest of some kind, and there was a stream. And we were walking through the woods together. And then the elder, he looked to be in his 90s, stopped. And the one that was about my age, he was probably middle-aged, walked me forward to a log that was crossing this stream. And when we walked across the stream, the elder that was standing back said to the younger one, "She will be a bridge between worlds." And then I woke up.
Wow.
And I was so happy. I woke up my husband and I said, honey, my guides finally came to me. The ancestors, they showed me they approve. I'm accepted. It was like what would you call that? An initiation ceremony almost.
Yes.
So that was amazing. And that was kind of when I got the big kick in the pants to start writing too. So that all kind of happened together at the same time. So yeah.
It's all happening. It seems like a lot of people these days are going through some sort of transition.
Transformation is happening.
Transformation.
Big time. Yeah, there are a lot of people in transformation right now, which gives me a whole lot of hope for the planet. It gives me a lot of hope for humanity right now, because the people that are transitioning, they're transitioning into a point where they will be able to help other people transition, and it will become like the 100th monkey theory, where eventually, if enough people transition, they will bring everybody else with them. It's been scientifically proven in the weirdest ways that, you know, when enough people get to a level of certain amount of knowledge, that is instantly shared among the whole species, which is one of the most fascinating things. Marky, have you heard of the 100th monkey?
I haven't. No, I'm more familiar with things like the Bacon number.
Really?
Have you heard of the Bacon number?
No, what is the Bacon number? Is that your breakfast plate?
It's like 6 degrees of separation or whatnot. How close each actor, any actor, is to Kevin Bacon. I've not heard of the 100th monkey. No, but, yeah, but what they, you say about if enough people do it, it will bring everyone else.
Yes.
They actually did an experiment
to prove this. So they actually took a group of, you know, monkeys and took them separated them from the rest of their group. And they put them through a situation where they would learn something. And when a certain number of them learned it, the rest of the group somehow suddenly started doing it, even though they were separated from them. So,
weird.
Yeah.
So without direct contact.
Yes. Well, it's like the everything is connected.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's like that, you know. You know,
one shift that I've recognized. Sorry for interrupting later.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, one thing that I know that has greatly enforced or infiltrated the planetary consciousness since, mm-hmm. let's say, 1999 and 2000, is prior to that, not many people knew of a cabal or elite class, or mm-hmm. they knew there was a feeling. But like now... Okay. You mention it and they go, oh, yeah, yeah, the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers and all these other things and everything they've studied. And so that's become aware in the global consciousness now.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I'm thinking it only takes like 5 to 15 years to get something fully like worldwide recognized.
I think it's even going to advance much quicker than that, because I mean that was in the early days of the internet, and the internet has been a catalyst for these changes, because it allows the communications to be more instantaneous globally. I mean,
and connected to more people at once.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you think about when you were a kid, you know, and you know, how would you connect to someone in Japan? You going to fly to Japan? Would you have to write a letter and have it mailed there and take weeks upon weeks to get there, and then maybe pen pal it back or a phone call?
Or an expensive phone call, yeah.
Yeah, really expensive phone call. but yeah, so it has changed everything about our reality. The internet has this instant communication that we have. So... It is, I think, a catalyst that is going to bring us to the next level of humanity, of human consciousness. And if we do it right, if we focus on raising our vibration, if we focus on kindness and love, if enough of us transition, it'll bring the rest of us. So it doesn't even matter the people that are negative right now and the people, you know, if enough of us switch up to this higher vibration, if enough of us are transferred over, if enough transformation happens, it will bring everybody else with it eventually. And it looks like we're kind of out of time for tonight. Wow. So, yeah, we're getting ready to be let go. Oh, my goodness. So,
thank you for having me on the show, Lenita.
Yeah, I really appreciate having you, Rodrigo. And Mark and Melina.
mm-hmm. No problem. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. All right, so that is it for tonight, everyone. Thank you for listening. Don't forget to visit on Facebook and Twitter, and also our website, anomalousrealities.com. Have a happy 4th of July, everyone, and a wonderful weekend. Good night.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.